Welcome to this webinar of Obesity Center CGG or Centrum Gezond Gewicht. My name is Liesbeth van Rossum. I'm internist, endocrinologist, and professor in the field of obesity and stress hormones at the Erasmus Medical Center. And this is my colleague.
And my name is Erika van den Akker. I'm pediatric endocrinologist. And together we founded Obesity Center CGG. But let's start with, what is obesity? Liesbeth.
Well, usually we define obesity by the body mass index, and that is the BMI is weight divided by squared height. And when a person has a BMI of 25 or more, we define it as overweight, and when it's 30 or more, we define it as obesity. And when looking at the numbers in the Netherlands, we see that from the adults, more than half of the population is overweight, and even 14% is living with obesity. And we also have the numbers of the children. But actually, we're talking about weight, but basically we should talk about fat mass, because fat is the problem in obesity, too much fat. And fat is an active organ producing over hundreds of hormones and other inflammatory factors. And when you have too much body fat, it's basically getting sick, just like a liver or a heart can get sick. Also, mechanical problems are being exerted. So basically, when you have too much fat, we see that it can lead to more than 200 complications. And the most common complications are type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, 13 forms of cancer, depression, but also a more severe cause of infections, such as COVID-19, and a lot of psychosocial problems. So basically, obesity is a gateway disease to many other diseases. So because this is a society problem, we thought it's necessary to launch an obesity center CGG. And Erika and I started our patient clinics in 2011, and we had an official opening with Queen Maxima in 2014 when we started our collaboration with the Franciscus Hospital. And 2 years later, we also started with the other regional hospital, the Maastricht Hospital. So we have several main objectives of our obesity center CGG. And to start off, the first objective is the diagnostics of underlying causes of obesity in children and adults. And looking at underlying causes, there are many. The most common cause, of course, is lifestyle-related obesity. And we all know eating unhealthy, exercising not enough, but also a lot of social factors. For example, people who live in poverty, they often have an unhealthy lifestyle. So this is a very common cause of obesity. But also other causes can exist. For example, psychic causes like stress or eating disorders. Medication-related obesity is also an important factor. We found that almost half of the patients we saw with obesity had at least one or more medications with a potential weight-gaining side effect, and that can also impair sometimes weight loss. And another factor or cause of obesity can be hormonal disease, can be a common disease like hypothyroidism or polycystic ovary syndrome, but sometimes also more rare hormonal diseases can exist. And then we have two more rare categories, hypothalamic obesity or monogenic obesity, and we come later to this. So therefore, you can understand that it's really important to personalize the treatment based on the underlying cause and based on the individual characteristics and develop innovative treatments, because there's a pandemic going on right now and we have to treat the people who are already have obesity. So Erika, can you maybe explain what is different in the body weight regulation when people are living with obesity?
Well, first you have to understand what is the normal regulation of fat mass. Fat mass is an organ that produces leptin. And leptin is a hormone that gives information to your brain. And it gives information on how much energy storage does your body have. So if there's more fat mass, there's more leptin, and the brain sees that there is more energy storage. And as a result, if there is enough, it reduces food intake and it increases energy expenditure. But what happens if this system doesn't work well? For example, like we know, in patients who have a defect in the sensing of leptin because of a genetic defect in the leptin receptor. For example, in this patient, you can see that it goes very wrong with your weight from birth onwards. In this BMI curve of her first 2 years, you see an immense increase because of her insatiable behavior, her hyperphagia. She gained weight until she was 20 kilograms already at the age of 2. And you can see that her family members, her younger sister, have a totally, who does not have this defect, have a total different body composition. So this is a rare disease. But what is the case in obesity? There's also a sensing defect in for leptin. In obesity, fat mass is increased, leptin levels are increased, but the brain does not sense the leptin as well. There's leptin resistance. And that is caused by all the factors that Liesbeth already mentioned, hormonal factors and inflammatory factors that are produced by the fat mass. And due to that leptin resistance, there is less reduced food intake and less increased metabolism in people with obesity. So this is really a biological disease. And this homeostatic system is very important in this regulation. But that is not all there is to it. There's more in this regulating system. Liesbeth, can you tell us more about that?
So in addition to the fat hormone leptin, there are also other intestinal hormones which helps to feel satiety, so make you feel full after, for example, a dinner. And it's good to know that in our system, we make over 200 food choices a day, and the majority is unconscious, and it's being regulated by this biological system. We have hunger hormones making you hungry, but we have also these hormones, leptin and other intestinal hormones, which make you feel full. But sometimes this homeostatic system is working properly, but you're feeling full, but you can still eat and continue eating. And that is a mechanism which is related to the hedonic system, because you can only eat food if it's really delicious. For example, comfort food, like a dessert after a meal. And this is more related to the reward system in the hypothalamus in the brain, the regulatory system of our appetite, and it's related to dopamine and serotonin, all kinds of neurotransmitters. And it's important to know that this system exists because it can be influenced. So how can it be influenced? For example, if you see this picture of donuts, I'm not sure if you like donuts, but if you like them, your body will start to produce hunger hormones, and your body will get prepared to receive food with high caloric content, high sugary and high fat content. And this is what's happening all around us, because if you're walking around at a central station to take a train, for example, you will see all around you comfort food. And unconsciously, you're more prone to take it. So our environment is provoking us to eat unhealthy. And there's another thing which is important, because if we eat a lot of processed food, which is the majority in supermarkets right now, also our satiety hormones are being influenced, and our hunger hormones as well. And this disturbance is caused by our environment partially and by our choice of food. But also, when you are living with obesity, the whole fat mass is altered and your satiety hormones are being altered as well. And this means that once you have been developed obesity, that your body becomes reprogrammed, and the body always wants to go back to the higher weight. Despite weight loss, you need to do much more to maintain your weight last, partially because these satiety hormones and hunger hormones are altered in a different way. So that is really important and makes it hard to lose weight. It's not impossible, but it's harder than average. So if you want to treat a person with obesity, what we do in the Obesity Center CGG is first look at all the individual characteristics to look at what are the individual causes in this person contributing to weight gain or impairing weight loss. And then we will adjust one of the treatments to this person, what is needed. The interventions which are available currently in the Netherlands are, for example, the combined lifestyle intervention for adults. It's a two-year program with coaching on healthy lifestyle, healthy food, exercise, but also on stress and sleep. And this has been covered since recently by the basic insurance. And actually, our obesity center, CGG, played a major role in this coverage by the insurance companies. And also, for people who already have been doing a combined lifestyle intervention, but didn't lose any weight or not enough, it's important to not just leave it like that and wait before there is a heart attack or cancer is being developed, but really take obesity as a disease seriously and have additional therapies, like add-on therapies like obesity medication. There are several since last year, or sometimes targeted medication. We come to that later. Or sometimes when the BMI is really high, you also can need bariatric surgery.
Yeah, so the question is, does it matter what kind of underlying cause you have, what type of intervention you need? Well, the most common causes are do need intensive lifestyle intervention, but no matter what type of cause you have, lifestyle is the basis of any intervention. And there is still a lot to win there. For example, we know that there are now guidelines on recommended physical activity for adults as well as for children. And we can see that those are not met in the largest part of the population. For example, that's the case for many countries in Europe, as well as half of the children in the Netherlands do not meet those guidelines. And when you zoom in on that amount, you see that especially adolescents have the lowest figures in this. So that's important. And in the Maastricht study, it was shown that environmental measures, for example, during Corona, have a major impact on this. And we see, and this, so this is the case for everybody. Preventive measures on lifestyle are important for everybody. But especially for the vulnerable group, which we see in our patients with severe obesity, it is important to have extra measures for this group, which has the most health problems. In addition to lifestyle measures, what happens when you have another underlying cause, like a disease, like a genetic obesity? Think of the patient that we presented before, the one with leptin receptor deficiency. She needs, on top of general advice, she needs tailored treatment. For example, her energy expenditure is decreased. She has bowing of the legs and needs special shoes. And her parents need coaching because of her insatiable behavior. And there you can see that on her BMI, there is an immense effect with this tailored lifestyle intervention. However, it will never get back to normal with lifestyle only. It is important, therefore, to diagnose these patients. But how do we do that? How do we find these patients between the large amount of obese patients? Well, in our obesity center CGG, we have several care paths for different types of patients. And for this type of patient with the early onset severe obesity and hyperphagia, we have a special care path, a diagnostic care path, which leads to their diagnosis. And there you can see if you have a holistic approach with questionnaires, lab tests, genetic testing, it is possible to have a high yield of those diagnoses. 1 in 5 of those patients, we identified specific underlying causes who need specific treatment. Because on top of the lifestyle, they do need development of novel drug treatment. There currently is no existent drug for those patients. And so therefore, we are one of the centers who work in an international consortium on clinical trials, phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trials in the development of novel drugs. For example, this drug, setmelanotide, which was recently approved by the FDA and by the EMA. And here you can see the immense effect that drugs can have for those patients. The blue line is the hunger score in these patients. Normally they have a hunger score of around 80 or 90, and you see that the drug lowers it to around 20 to 30. And coinciding with that decrease in hunger, they have a decrease in weight, which can be as much as almost 30% of their baseline weight that they decrease. So this is new hope for those patients. But in addition to clinical trials, another very important objective is basic and translational research.
In the context of research, we are collaborating with multiple clinical departments, as shown here, as well as major laboratories like Laboratory of Metabolism and Reproduction and Laboratory of Neuroendocrinology and many other departments. We are happy also to show you here our team. This is our research team, but also consisting of clinicians, policymakers, and here you can see the faces. Within the Obesity Center CGG, we have some main research projects. Basic and translational, we have the biobank and a whole registry of patient-related data. We have genetic obesity studies, clinical and also functional studies on genes causing monogenic obesity. We have also a focus on the stress hormone cortisol and exogenous use of corticosteroids and their metabolism. And in addition, we have clinical trials, but also the Obesity Care Project, which is a development of an e-tool to assist clinicians to phenotype patients and to do diagnostics of underlying causes and to develop treatments based on the person. We do that together with TNO and in support of the Liesbeth Foundation. In addition, we have several society roles as also in the context of research.
And for all of this, it's necessary to work together in a network. We have a regional network, for example, to do shared care with patients, with general hospitals, and with our partners on Obesity Center CGG, and the e-health tool with TNO, but also a national network, because we see patients from the whole of the Netherlands, and because the guideline development needs to be on a national basis. And for the more rare diseases like genetic obesity, you need an international network to work together on the clinical trials. And then we come to our fourth objective, societal impact. There we work on a national level on transfer of knowledge, for example, through guideline development, through education, not only of medical and healthcare professionals, but also for lay people. And we do that in many ways with a large team. And here you see that everybody in the team, PhD students, research assistant, everybody helps to transfer knowledge to the public in this way. And the second aim is to reduce the stigma on obesity, because that is what is needed if you want to win this game.
And another example of our society role is that we influence obesity policy, for example, in our country, by chairing the partnership Overweight Netherlands. We have many projects commissioned by the Ministry of Health. For example, we develop a network approach for adults with overweight, and thereby we connect the social domain and the medical domain to improve care for people with overweight and obesity. And we also contribute, for example, to the National Prevention Agreement. International level, we are also very active, and our Obesity Center CGG has officially been appointed as a collaborative obesity management center by the European Association for the Study of Obesity, and we are involved in many of the European societies who are involved in obesity care and obesity research. So another example of society impact is translating scientific knowledge to policy making. And for example, during the first wave of the COVID-19 pandemic, we published results on a study in our combined lifestyle interventions for people with obesity and showed that the immune system was improving during this lifestyle intervention. And that's important news to be more resistant to the effects of infections, potentially also COVID-19. And we thought this improvement of the immune system by lifestyle intervention was important news also for the Minister of Health, who obviously will not have time to read the science. So what we did is we wrote a letter to the Minister of Health, and to our happiness, actually it was being signed by more than 3,000 healthcare professionals and more than 300 healthcare professional organizations. Within 24 hours, a website was built around it, and we sent it to the minister. And the day we signed it to the minister, it was major press conference, press coverage around it. And importantly, the Minister of Health indeed read it and mentioned it during the press conference that lifestyle is important. But more importantly, it resulted in major national lifestyle campaigns. And also, we're discussing now improvement of the national prevention agreement to enable a more healthy food environment, for example. And another example of translation of science to lay audience is the release of this book. Irka and I and the whole team are gathered a lot of knowledge due to clinical work and research. And together with Mariette Bone, a colleague from Leiden, we wrote the book Fat Belangrijk, or Fat the Secret Organ. And this appeared to be an international bestseller and was being read not only by lay audience, but by our patients and informing, they were more informed about what could be the underlying cause of my obesity, what could contribute, how can I control my weight, but it's also read by healthcare professionals, and that may also improve obesity care. To finish, I would like to zoom out, because this is the current situation in the world right now. What is happening is there's a water tap wide open, and that means that there are more and more people with overweight and obesity. There's a pandemic going on right now. And at the same time, the bath is full. There are already many people with overweight or obesity. And we should do two things. We should close the tap, and that means we need more preventive measures, healthy food environment, more exercise, maybe prices should be adjusted. That's what we need to do, of course, to close the tap. But then still the bath is full. And that means for the people who already have obesity, which is a chronic disease, we need better treatments. And then we can empty the bath. So we should do both. So it's to conclude, considering obesity, it's important to realize it's a chronic relapsing disease. And to help persons with obesity, we should first do proper diagnostics. What is the underlying cause? Look at all the barriers and facilitators, optimize when start treatment, and then do proper treatment like combined lifestyle interventions and potentially as add-on therapies, pharmacotherapy or bariatric surgery. And it's clear that we also need innovative and more effective and personalized treatments, also e-health based. And because it's a lifelong disease, we need a proper monitoring and maintenance of this weight loss programs. For all these, we need clinical research, but also basic and translational research. So at the society level, as I mentioned, we need to close the tap, we should empty the bath, and that all is also very important to reduce the severe stigma which people with obesity are still suffering for. And this is where Centrum Gezond Gewicht, or Obesity Center CGG, is standing for.
We hope you enjoyed this webinar. Thank you for your attention.